So let's continue our discussion by talking about a few of the properties of some of the most common semiconductors. So this is an image of the periodic table. You've probably all seen this in your chemistry courses. The particular column, you'll recall that the elements in a column in the periodic table have the same number of valence electrons. Column 4 is particularly important for us because it's a column that the most common semiconductors occur in. And in column 4, we have 4 valence electrons per atom. So silicon is in column 4. It's the most common semiconductor. You can also see that germanium is in column 4. It's also a common semiconductor. Carbon, we would not really consider a semiconductor because its band gap is so wide, we think of it more as an insulator. Okay. Now, there are other semiconductors that are made from other columns, some common ones. For example, if I look at column 3, the elements in column 3 have 3 valence electrons. If I look in column 5, the elements in column 5 have 5 valence electrons. If I make compounds of materials between column 3 and column 5, on average, they will have 4 valence electrons per atom, and they'll behave as semiconductors. So one particularly important example is gallium from column 3 and arsenic from column 5. If we make a compound gallium arsenide, that is also a very commonly used semiconductor. So we can continue. In column 6, there are 6 valence electrons per atom. In column 2 here, there are 2 valence electrons per atom. Zinc is from column 2. Selenium is from column 6. These would be called 2-6 semiconductors. On average, there would be 4 valence electrons per atom, and they would behave as semiconductors also. Now, there are other materials that also have properties of semiconductors, but a lot of the most common semiconductors come from this part of the periodic table, column 4 or columns adjacent to column 4, such that we get an average number of valence electrons that is equal to 4. Now, in looking at any of these semiconductors, there are a couple of key numbers that are very important to us. And we've talked about these before. The first number is the band gap, the separation between the valence band, the top of the valence band, and the bottom of the conduction band. Okay. In silicon, that number is 1.1 electron volts. The other important number is the intrinsic carrier density, which comes from breaking these covalent bonds and creating holes in the valence band and electrons in the conduction band. That number in silicon is almost exactly 1 times 10 to the 10th at 300 Kelvin. Remember that there is a very tight relation between band gap and intrinsic carrier concentration. The intrinsic carrier concentration depends exponentially on the band gap. As the band gap gets wider, it gets exponentially harder to break those bonds, and the intrinsic carrier concentration gets exponentially smaller. As the band gap gets smaller, it gets easier to create these electron hole pairs, and the semiconductor has a larger and larger intrinsic carrier concentration. So here are a few numbers. Germanium has a band gap of about 0.66 electron volts. It has an intrinsic carrier density of about 2 times 10 to the 13th, more than 1,000 times larger than silicon. Silicon, we've discussed. Gallium arsenide, for example, has a band gap that's about 3/10 of an electron volt larger than silicon. And it has an intrinsic carrier density that is almost 4 orders of magnitude smaller because of that exponential dependence. So later on in the course, we're going to see that it will be how we can actually calculate what this intrinsic carrier density is given the properties of the semiconductor. Now, I want to pause here just for a second. There are many different types of semiconductors, and we might ask, why is silicon the one that is most common and most pervasive? It's actually not because it has the best electronic properties. There's actually another reason. And that reason has to do with the fact that, silicon has some remarkable property that makes it so easy to use and to manufacture high-performance devices from. Recall that inside the crystal, each atom has 4 nearest neighbors, but we've got to terminate the crystal on a face somewhere, and we may build our device on that face. But the surface is a place where there are lots of defects. the atoms on the surface don't have atoms above them to bond to. This leads to dangling bonds. There are electrons that have nothing to bond to. These create defects. Usually these defects are electronically active and they degrade the performance of a device severely. Now, silicon has a remarkable property. It has a native oxide, silicon dioxide. Silicon dioxide is a hard, high-quality insulator. Its crystalline form is quartz. But the property that's most important for us is that it has the property of tying up these dangling bonds. We say that it passivates the dangling bonds and basically renders these defects electrically inactive so that we can build electronic devices on surfaces of silicon. Other semiconductors don't have that particularly nice property, and this is what's led to the widespread use, common use of silicon in so many different applications. There are specific applications for which silicon is just not suitable, and then we have to find other ways of building devices from other semiconductors. Now, later on in the course, we're going to say quite a bit more about the recombination process, but I just want to say a couple of words at this point, and then we'll return to it later in the course. Remember, we talked about how it's possible for an electron to fall back down into the valence band, an electron in the conduction band to drop down into the valence band and fill up that hole or replace that covalent bond. This is called a recombination process. After this process has occurred, we have one fewer electrons in the conduction band and one fewer holes in the valence band. Now, there's some energy that has to be given up when the electron drops down to the valence band. That energy has to go somewhere. And there are two possibilities. That energy can go into light. We can emit photons. This is what happens in some semiconductors. For example, in gallium arsenide, the 3-5 semiconductor that we talked about, this is called a direct gap semiconductor, and we'll talk about what that means a little bit later. In semiconductors like this, the excess energy is given up into light, and this is a way that we make light-emitting diodes and lasers and other devices from semiconductors. The other possibility is that the excess energy is given up by heat. And this just heats up the silicon lattice. Usually when the silicon lattice gets hotter, the intrinsic carrier concentration gets hotter, various processes occur that degrade the performance of the device. Your cell phone or laptop, if you notice it getting warm after you're using it for a while, it's because in semiconductors like silicon, when these recombination processes occur, the energy is usually given up into heat. These are called indirect gap semiconductors, and we'll talk a little bit later about what that means. Now, there are other important properties. We've just mentioned a few of them here. We'll talk later about how fast can these charge carriers, these electrons in the conduction band or the holes in the valence band, how fast do they move in semiconductors? The faster they move, the more current they can carry. There's a parameter called mobility that defines that. It's important frequently to know what the thermal conductivity is because we don't want our silicon lattice or our semiconductor lattice to heat up too much. Now, it's possible if we apply large voltages to semiconductors to have electric fields that are so strong that the field can rip electrons out of the covalent bonds. When that happens, the semiconductor breaks down. There's another concept called effective mass that we'll discuss in the next lecture. So there are a variety of other properties, but we've mentioned here in this lecture some of the most important ones. So just to summarize, silicon is the most commonly used semiconductor, not because it has the best electronic properties of any semiconductor, but it has good electronic properties. But the primary reason that it's used so extensively is that it has this native oxide that passivates and renders defects on the surface electrically inactive. Other semiconductors are used when silicon just isn't suitable. You know, one example is to make light-emitting diodes. Silicon doesn't have this property of emitting light when recombination occurs. And the two most important parameters of a semiconductor, the first two things we generally look at are what is its band gap, and then what is its intrinsic carrier concentration, which is related to its band gap. There are other parameters that we'll discuss as the course evolves, but these are the two first parameters that we look at when we're considering semiconductors for applications. So in the next lecture, we will continue this discussion, and we'll talk about the properties of these charge carriers that move throughout a semiconductor device and that give rise to electrical currents that make semiconductor devices operate.